Okay, on a continuation of our discussion related, still related on the drugs affecting the lactation and pregnancy, or on the other hand, pregnancy and lactation. So we have, as a review, we have discussed the topics and drugs that are related to the drugs on for minor discomforts during pregnancy. We have discussed also the drugs that are indicated for the control of the preterm labor. What are the drugs that can that are indicated for preterm delivery? As also review, we have a discussion on the drugs that significantly manages labor pains during latent phase. Now, our discussion will focus on the aspect or topics that is significant for pain control during labor. And this is different from the discussion of the sedation or sedative drugs, because usually the pain control that we're talking to is on the last phase of labor and during delivery. Okay, when we talk about anesthesia, it's loss of painful sensation with or without loss of consciousness. So actually, we have already differentiate sedation from the anesthesia. From the sedation, it usually considers the diminish of the mental and physical responsiveness. And when we talk about anesthesia, the loss of painful sensation could be with or without loss of consciousness. Usually, the anesthesia that may cause the possible loss of consciousness is through the general anesthesia. And most, when we are considering anesthetic effect, when it comes to without the loss of consciousness, are usually either a localized anesthesia, which is from the term itself, localized, only specific area will be subject on the effect of loss of painful sensations. While we are talking about spinal anesthesia, the client can still be, may not significantly affect the loss of consciousness because of such effect of loss of painful sensation is within the abdominal, or rather abdominal or waist below. So basically these are anesthesias, and there are pain that had been managed by anesthesia. So we have the visceral pain and we have the somatic pain. Usually when we talk about the visceral pain during the progress of labor, the reference that we could consider, if the labor is progressing and if the labor itself is near to the phase wherein it may lead to the delivery of the newborn, is depending on the pain that it can manifest to the pregnant client. So if we're talking about the visceral pain, this considers specifically the effect on the stretching of the sympathetic fibers via the cervix and the uterus. So meaning, even during the labor, when there is a progression on the uterine contraction, because we all know that within the uterine wall and the uterine muscle contraction is stretching upon, and it is it coincides with the effacement and the opening of the cervix. So once it causes the progression of labor, the more and the frequent uterine contractions occurred, and it coincides with the changes of effacement on the cervical opening. So when it causes the stretching of these fibers, sympathetic fibers, it entails also the response of the pain receptors. So that is what we call visceral pain. When we talk about the somatic pain on the physiology of the labor and delivery, this usually is considered as the pressure wherein the stretching of the perineum, and the vagina when the baby is about to be delivered on a normal spontaneous vaginal delivery. This is what we call somatic pain. So again, anatomically, we could identify the visceral pain with the involvement of the cervix and the uterus. And when it comes to the somatic pain, it is on the perineum and the vagina, wherein this is the actual phase wherein the baby is about to deliver or had been delivered. So now, when we are going to do the discussion now on what are the differences of the regional anesthesia. Actually, if we talk about the regional anesthesia from the term itself, region, so there is a specific area only that may induce the loss of pain sensation. So that's why we have the what we call local anesthetics and the regional blocks. So if we talk about the local anesthetic, it considered only an area, just an area, localized. So ibig sabihin, it can only identify the specific area wherein it may cause the loss of sensation. So just a typical example is episiotomy. So if we consider episiotomy, so this is somehow a creation of the opening on the between the area to facilitate and to episiotomy is done to prevent the tearing, okay, of the tissues. So this is to eventually when the pressure is exerted upon the delivery of the baby, episiotomy is necessary if it usually considers that the baby is large vis-a-vis with the opening, okay, with the opening. So the doctor to prevent the tearing of the tissue, then and lacerations as well. This may specifically create what we call episiotomy. So when we talk about the regional blocks, this is what we call epidural and spinal anesthesia. So when it comes to local anesthesia and regional blocks, local anesthesia, the area is in the perineum, okay? So specific. When we talk about the regional, it's either that the upper extremities will be affected or not affected, will lose its pain sensation, or the lower extremities. But usually, when we talk about the spinal anesthesia, as what I have mentioned, spinal, which is obviously administered by the spinal area, so the client may have loss of pain sensation from abdominal area down. Okay? But usually, as what I have mentioned to you, that anesthetics may not specifically affect the contraction of the uterine wall. So that's why even the client is about to deliver and the cervix is fully dilated, the client can still feel the pain accordingly because of the pressure created by the uterine contraction. And that is the time that the client will be instructed to bear down. Okay? So that to facilitate the smooth delivery of the baby until to its extra uterine life. So now we differentiate the local anesthesia in the regional block. So that's why it is called as regional anesthesia. So there are some situations that we need to consider on the contraindications of regional anesthesia, because anesthesia, since it may possibly, okay, it may possibly have the effect, the anesthetic effect may cause affectation specifically on the function of the heart. It could significantly affect on the coagulating factors. So, on the regional anesthesia, the contraindication is if the client is on severe gestational hypertension, because when the client be given with the regional anesthesia, such as spinal anesthesia, the epidural, so this may cause the possibility of elevated blood pressure. It may induce elevated blood pressure, or probably it may aggravate hypertension. Another is regional anesthesia can be contraindicated if coagulating factors or one of the components of the blood which is significant for coagulation, which is the platelet, is decreased. Why? Because regional anesthesia may cause the possibility of bleeding, and since the platelet could be possibly affected and coagulating factors could be possibly affected if identified with coagulation disorders, then it is expected upon during delivery there is passage of blood, and this may not be controlled if regional anesthesia may be given. So these are risks. So that's why nurses must take into consideration on how to do the very effective physical examination. So other than is to regional anesthesia is contraindicated to generalized sepsis. If we define sepsis, this is related to severe infection or local infection at the needle site. So for example, there's a localized infection specifically on the perineal area, so we cannot do the localized administration of the local anesthesia. So if there is an infection or severe infection identified in the spinal fluid or specifically in the area of administration on the needle site, so these are chances that may aggravate the chances of sepsis, and this is also an indication to prevent the septic shock. Now, what are the common anesthetic use or anesthesia that is used in obstetrics? So you must be aware of this. Although if you try to evaluate the four example of anesthesia, one of which is number three, okay, which is number three, is only categorized as category B. It's the lidocaine injectable, and usually the lidocaine injectable are used as local anesthesia. So the rest, which is number one, number two, and number three, okay, number three, this could be given as epidural, spinal, or either epidural or spinal. So that's why if chlorprocaine, so it is category C, so it is based from the pregnancy risk category of drugs that it may cause an effect to the fetus. So that's why the nurse must take into consideration that even during labor or upon delivery of the baby, let us try to consider if the response of the baby is active. So because we all know that since it is category C, it may cause an effect to the baby. So this is usually for lumbar, okay, lumbar epidural block. So if we say given the by the lumbar epidural block, so the lumbar and the spinal anesthesia may have the same site. However, the effect of the lumbar epidural block could be these are also regional area wherein the tetracaine that is used for spinal anesthesia is a common as anesthesia, and the spinal, as based from my experience, usually the spinal anesthesia are given to clients who undergo the normal spontaneous delivery if they want a painless delivery. Pero as much as possible, they may not be given with anesthesia so that it may not affect the consciousness of the mother in bearing down. But if the client is in severe pain, or if the client may request a painless delivery, but still, as what we have mentioned, this may lose the pain, the loss of pain sensation, but still the client is conscious. So when it comes to number four, bupivacaine, this is usually the drug that could be given epidural or spinal anesthesia, okay? And this is usually indicated for the cesarean delivery. So it means that, sir, question, the number one, the number two ba can be given also to cesarean section? It can be given to cesarean section. But moreover, for painless delivery, it could be the lumbar or spinal anesthesia. But for the number four, which is bupivacaine, this is usually the anesthetic that is being given or being administered during cesarean delivery. However, there is a precaution that 75% not recommended. Okay, bupivacaine as literature, as per literature, because of the 0.75, that is 75%, 0.75% of incidences that leads to cardiac arrest. Kasi any anesthetic effect, you really need to monitor the vital signs. Even after the client have delivered via either normal spontaneous delivery or by a cesarean section, vital signs are very crucial for the next 2 hours. So that's why we monitor it, start with every 30 minutes until every hour, okay, until every hour, so that to check any effect of the anesthesia pertaining to respiration, because we all know its anesthetic effect may significantly affect the respiratory center, because we all know that these drugs may affect the function of the central nervous system. So the usual that could be affected is the regulation of the blood pressure, which that's why we need to monitor the BP, respiratory center, which we need to monitor the respiratory rate and the pulses for the sufficient circulation that is significant for the tissues in cells. So these are the example of four anesthetic effects. Okay, so now we'll proceed to the drugs. Okay, the drugs that enhance uterine muscle contractility, because after the delivery, it is expected that the baby had been delivered, okay, the newborn had been delivered, so chances that the uterine muscle contractions will shift to relaxation, okay, because there's nothing to do anymore to have the contraction. However, we still have the hormones of the client, okay, of the pregnant client, to prevent bleeding. There's a need to sustain or maintain the contracted uterus or uterine muscle. This is to prevent the further bleeding. So if not pharmacological management is sometimes we put the ice bag on the abdominal, specifically on the uterine area, so that to facilitate uterine muscle contraction and may prevent bleeding. If this could not be managed by the non-pharmacological management, so it could consider the uterotropic drugs. Okay, so if we say uterotropic drugs, this is the opposite of the tocolytics, because in the tocolytics it inhibits uterine contraction. In uterotropic drug, it enhances uterine contractility. So one of the most common example is the oxytocin. Okay, so oxytocin, it is usually to control postpartum hemorrhage. Okay, and usually when the labor is not progressing, okay, the labor is not progressing, there are no specifically effacement of the cervix to induce the progression of labor. If usually this situation happens when the client is supposedly on the expected date of confinement or already full term, usually oxytocin could be given as a trial to induce the labor. If there are situations that the client exceeded the expected date of confinement, so it's post term, so if we need to induce labor, if the client could be subject for the normal spontaneous delivery. So this is to prevent uterine atony. So the uterine atony is to post delivery to prevent the continuous relaxation of the uterus, which eventually may lead to the profuse bleeding. So that is what we call uterine atony. So the drug of choice is oxytocin. However, these are category C. Why? Because as what we had mentioned, the category C, if it is on the level of the level or on the phase of labor, once we induce the labor, the chances also that may cause uterine contractility and eventually may affect also the fetal activity inside the uterus. So careful. So prevention of fetal distress is to monitor the fetal heart tone or the fetal heart rate. So another is, we could give also, aside from the oxytocin, we could give also methylergonovine or maleate, or sometimes there are the brand name that is being used is Metergine. So the prevention, obviously the same with oxytocin, prevention of postpartum hemorrhage. The subinvolution, okay, subinvolution is basically similar to the situation wherein there could be a problem on the non-reactive uterus when it comes to contraction, and this may cause also passive. These are also given if the client had been subjected to dilatation and curettage, post-abortion hemorrhage, so that to maintain the contraction of the uterus and prevent further bleeding. However, these are contraindicated to clients who may have maternal infection. These do not use with vasodepressors. So these are another drug. So again, if we have the oxytocin, actually, oxytocin may not be given to the client if specifically the natural oxytocin hormone is stimulated naturally, but to make sure that since the client may have the anesthetic effect and the delayed responses accordingly to the drugs are also delayed, So the doctor usually prescribes the oxytocin, or the number two, we have the Metergine. So I think that is the last topic of the drugs affecting pregnancy and lactation. So I hope you learn from the drugs affecting pregnancy and lactation. So the next video will be related again to a synchronous session, which may discuss specifically drugs affecting respiratory system. Thank you very much.